afternoon, I'm Luciano Prono, and I will present an optimized compress sensing decoder based on deep neural network support prediction. I start with a brief introduction to compress sensing. We will see how signals can be encoded using compress sensing technique. We will follow with how can we decode the compress signals. And we will then see our framework, which is the trainable compress sensing with support oracle, which we use to decode our signals. Then we will see the performance of our framework on the reconstruction of synthetic ECGs and EEGs. And finally, we will see how it is possible to add the self-assessment capabilities to our framework. The conclusion will follow. Now, compress sensing is a technique that allows us to sample a signal with a rate which is below the Nyquist rate. This is possible only for signals which are sparse. Sparse signals, typical sparse signals, are signals such as biosignals, so ECG and EEGs. This is good because we can achieve lower energies at the encoding side of our architecture. In fact, we have less samples to be acquired and less samples to be transmitted. But this comes with a drawback at the decoding side, as the decoding of this signal, these compressed signals, is quite computationally heavy. So, how is the compression performed? We have a signal. For example, here we have an ECG signal. This signal is split in windows, and it is compressed separately for each window. So, each window can be compressed during acquisition in an analog-like fashion, or it can be compressed after the acquisition with digital integration. Compressed sensing of a single window is basically a vector matrix multiplication. So we have X, which is our original vector, is the vector of the original window of the signal, which has N samples. We have a matrix A, which is the sensing matrix, which is M times N. And then we have the vector of the measurements Y, which has M samples. And we have M, which is lower than N. So we by multiplying by A, we compress the signal. Matrix A is generally random, but there are techniques which allows us to maximize the energy which is kept during compression. For example, we can use the Rakeness technique. It is also possible to use, without a loss in performance, antipodal sensing matrices, which is good because during encoding, we only need to perform sine sums instead of multiplications. Now, I said that we need sparse signals. A signal is sparse if it can be represented in a sparsity basis D. So if we have X equal to sparsity basis D multiplied by a vector Xi, we have Xi, which is a sparse vector. This means that only a few entries of vector Xi are non-zero. It is also possible to define a vector S as the support vector of Xi. The support vector contains ones where we have non-zero values of Xi, and contains zeros otherwise. So it is a vector which that indicates us where are the non-zero coefficients in Xi. Now we can summarize what we have seen until now. We can multiply matrices A and B, so the sensing matrices, the sensing matrix, and the dictionary matrix. We obtain a matrix B, which is M times N. And we can we obtain a direct relation between xc and y. So we have a new system, which is y equal to b times xc. This system has to be solved in order to decode the signal. So we do not know vector xc, but we do know our compressed measurements y and the matrix b. The problem is that this system is underdetermined, so we have more than one solution for this system, because we have less equations than unknowns. What can we do to solve this? Well, we can use vector S, the support vector, which have to be evaluated somehow. We will see how. This vector can be used to select only the columns of matrix B, such that we can reduce our system. We can reduce the number of unknowns of the system and search only for the ones we actually need. And we obtain another system which is overdetermined. So we have no solutions, but we can obtain a unique approximated solution. This solution can be evaluated by solving the least mean squares problem. This can be done trivially by applying the Moore-Penrose pseudo-inverse operation on the on matrix B. So we actually find the coefficients of a straight line which tries to approximate the points in the space which are described by the measurements y and the rows of the matrix B. And after we obtain xc, we can obtain the reconstructed signal x hat by using again the sparsity matrix B. So we finally obtain a reconstructed signal x hat. Now, the main problem is how we obtain, how we evaluate the support vector S, because this is a combinatorial problem, so it is computationally heavy. Many methods try to solve this by finding approximate solutions. We can try, for example, to minimize the L1 norm of vector xc with, for example, basis pools with denoising. We can use heuristic methods such as generalized approximate message passing, or we can employ iterative and greedy algorithms such as the orthogonal matching pool suite. Our method, which is based on the trainable compressed sensing with support oracle framework, on the other hand, tries to estimate the support vector S with the use of a support oracle. So we have a support oracle which takes in input the measurements, outputs the predicted version of the support S, and then solves the less mean square problem as we have seen before. Now, the support oracle is basically a deep neural network. We can see the deep neural network takes in input the measurements Y and tries to output the support of the original signal X. During the training of the network, we send in input the signal, the original signal X. We compress this signal directly inside the network. So we have basically an autoencoder, because we have the sensing matrix directly inserted in the first layer. Then the network tries to obtain to replicate the support of the original signal by minimizing a categorical cross entropy cost function. And then we have at the output a thresholder, which makes the output so that they are only or zero or ones. The threshold value of the thresholder is optimized along with the rest of the network. Now, before we see the performance of this framework, we have to define some metrics used to see how good is the decoder. The first metric is the reconstruction signal to noise ratio, which is the logarithmic ratio between the original signal X and the error performed during the reconstruction. We can also evaluate if we have more than one signal, if we have, for example, a batch of signals of a particular class, for example, ECGs, we can evaluate the mean of these metrics. So we have the average reconstruction signal to noise ratio. And trivially, we can also count how many signals are correctly reconstructed by evaluating the probability of correct reconstruction. The probability of correct reconstruction counts how many signals have a reconstruction signal to noise ratio, which is greater than a threshold we have set. So our first test is performed with the synthetic electrocardiogram signals. To these signals, we inject the noise so that we have an intrinsic signal to noise ratio equal to 60 decibels. We have very short windows for this compression, which is equal to 64 samples. And we can see that our method, which is the TCSSO, is far better than other methods, which are widely used, in particular for a compression ratio greater than 2. We can, compression ratio is the ratio between the original dimensionality of the signal, so n, and the dimensionality of the compressed signal y. We do the same also for synthetic electroencephalogram signals with the same setup. And even though we have performance which are overall worse because electroencephalogram signals are less sparse than electrocardiogram signals, we can see that especially for high compression ratio, compressed ratio values, our method outperforms other commonly used methods. So finally, we can also add a self-assessment functionality to our framework. In fact, if we take the reconstructed signal XSET and we compress it again by multiplying it with the matrix with the sensing matrix A, we can obtain a measurement vector, a new measurement vector y hat, and we can compare this vector y hat with the original vector of measurements y. We obtain a new matrix, which is the reconstruction measurement noise ratio. This matrix is strictly correlated with, we see that it is strictly correlated with the reconstruction signal to noise ratio. And this is good because it gives us a way to assess how good is the reconstruction, for example, of a single signal without knowing what is actually the original signal. We do not know X. So we've seen a decoder based on a deep neural network, which is used to retrieve the support of the signal, which is the main problem in reconstructing signal compressed with compressed sensing. We have seen that this decoder surpasses by far many other methods, especially with our setup, so with the synthetic ECGs and EEGs, and especially with the high compression ratio. And in addition, with this framework, it is possible to add the self-assessment functionality to the decoder so that we can see in real time how good is the reconstruction of our compressed signal. In future works, we will try to reconstruct real signals as it is more difficult because real signals actually are less sparse than synthetic signals. And we will also try to implement the decoder on a physical device. And that's all. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Luciano, for your presentation. Now it's time for the question and answer session. We start from a very simple and generic question, which is, what are the applications of compressed sensing? Can you provide some applications? We see on with these lights that it seems to be extremely employed in biomedical applications. Are there other areas in which compressed sensing is employed?
Okay, thank you for your question. Compressed sensing is generally used when we have a sensor node. So we, for example, we have a patient. And we have to continuously analyze, for example, his ECG. We have to implement this on node sensor that needs to be low power. So we compress the signal at the sensor node. We transmit it generally to a server, for example. And then the decoding can happen on a server. So we basically transfer the energy consumption from the sensor node to the server, so that we can consume less power at the sensor node.
Okay, thank you. And now this last sentence is related to a question that I would like to ask you. That concerns the box scheme that you showed where there were the two antennas in transmission and in reception.
This one.
Can you, let's say, provide some details which are this term in transmission and this term in reception? I think, according to your previous answer, that the transmission is connected to a sensor, or am I wrong?
Yes, we basically have in the first half of these schematics on the left, we have a sensor node. So X is acquired by a sensor.
Okay.
Then encoding can happen both during acquisition. Mm-hmm. So that there are way to directly acquire the signal in a compressed way, so we have an analog compression, but it can also be encoded in digital. And that the main advantage is that we have a transmitter, so we have to transmit less samples to the receiver, so we consume less power.
Yeah.
And then at the receiver, we have the compressed signal Y, which is both sent the support oracle, which extract the support of the signal. And then it is also used to solve the less mean square problem. And the last box simply transform the signal from C to X. So it is again in the time domain. And then we have the reconstructed signal in output.
Thank you for your very detailed question. Now we have just other few questions. The first one is, which hardware platform will you use for implementing the decoder?
Well, now we thank which? You for.
Sorry, John. You can.
Thank you for the question. We are currently working on this. There are different platforms we are thinking about. We are thinking about custom devices in which we can lower the number of bits which is required in decoding. We have seen that in support oracle, for example, we need a very low number of bits. But at the same time, this kind of application could be useful on microcontrollers. Mm. So we are still exploring the solutions.
Thank you, Luciano. Then we have other two questions. What's the comparison between the different types of approaches of compressed sensing in the in one of the following slides? Okay, this type of comparisons were done in the software, so on a CPU or on a FPGA?
Thank you for your question. It was everything was done in on software in Python
programming. Okay. Then we have another question. Is this technique suitable for communications also? What are the main limits to its use? Processing time and reliability of the estimated vector?
Thank you for the kind question. I have to admit I actually cannot answer this question in detail, so I prefer to say anything, to say something which is wrong.
Okay. There is another last question. There is another question that I have right now. What kind of information can you get by looking at the R, M, and R as compared to the R, S, and R? Are they equivalent?
You're talking about this slide.
Yes.
So,
the question says, if what kind of information can you get by looking at the first one as compared to the second one? And the other question connected to this one is if they are equivalent or not.
Okay, thank you. This is an interesting question. We can see from this schematic, from this graph, we have on the ordinate, we have the reconstruction simple noise ratio, and on the other axis, we have the reconstruction measurement noise ratio. From these, we can see that they are correlated. So if one is high, also the other is high. It is not true for every instance of the signal. So there are cases in which the reconstruction measurement noise ratio is actually not the truth. So we can use this for the majority of signals, but it could be it could give a wrong result for some of them, and it could be used for a self assessment of the decoder. We basically do not know the original signal because we compress it and we cannot transmit to the computer. So we can use this for a fairly good system to see if what we have in output is good or not. And if it is not good, we can try to use other decoding methods which are computationally more expensive, for example, to try to decode better the signal. So it is a flag. It can give us a way to raise a flag which tells us warning this signal has been decoded wrong.
Okay. And now the questions are finished. Thank you, Luciano, for your very interesting talk.
Thank you for your attention.